telephone access line. So in the next 5 minutes, we will be starting this class, and it is the first class in 10, and it will be the introduction to Christian education. And this will be an interactive class. You can make your comments or ask questions by typing in the box. And if this is your first night and you want full instructions to what the class is all about, you can look at the archive recorded class that we made last week. It's Introduction to Christian Education, and it will give you explanation of what the class is all about. Tonight is our first formal class. That too would be recorded and archived. You can also, if you have Roku, you can also look at these classes on demand. On demand. So welcome, and we will be starting in a few minutes. God bless you. Again, this is the Faith Baptist Church International Ministries. We are broadcasting from Corum, and we welcome you to our live stream tonight. And if this is your first time that you're joining us, you can get all the explanation to the class, what the class is all about, on Roku as a recorded service on our website under archives, or sermons or classes in that category, and look for the Introduction to Christian Education, and you will get all the explanation that you would want. That is if you are joining us for the first time. So in another 2 minutes, we'll be starting tonight's class. And hello to everyone who is joining us on the telephone line. Hi, how are you? God bless you. Glad to have you. Any questions? Okay. Yeah, God bless. So, again, you can join us through a telephone line, through Roku, or the live stream through our website, or through our app on smartphones and pads. Amen. God bless you. Okay. It's just about 7 o'clock, and again, the book for this class is Introducing Christian Education, Foundation for the 21st Century edited by Michael J. Anthony. So let's begin with prayer. Most gracious God, we thank you for this occasion. We thank you how you continue to bless us through the teaching of your word. Bless your students, Lord. Bless the instructor as we seek to do your will. Amen. It's good to get a good historical background, understanding of whatever you're studying, whatever subject you're studying. In case of Christian education, there is a long history that we have to go by. So, in chapter 1, page 17, it is mentioned there, teaching and learning in the Old and New Testaments. Bear in mind, when we talk about the Old Testament, we're talking about at least 5,000 years ago. Now, throughout the early history of Israel, the family was the chief educational institution of society. So, fathers were to teach their children God's law, as well as teaching them a trade. Now, in the long history of Israel, at times they were taken into captivity, and then that became a problem. The captivity in Egypt, little or no teaching was done, obviously, because they were in high slavery. And you can see, if you're familiar, that when God called Moses to go and get the people out of bondage, that they didn't really have a knowledge of who God was. And so right away it brings an important point, that how can we know who God is unless we are taught? And so they, during the time of what is called a Babylonian exile, there was a little bit, wasn't totally lost. But when they returned from exile, they had to really do a lot of teaching in order to bring the people in line of what God wanted them to know and to do. Then we get to the New Testament. And of course, the principal teacher in the New Testament of Christianity would be Jesus. And Jesus, being a rabbi or functioned in the role of a rabbi, thought as a rabbi, and as you know, did his own interpretation of the scriptures, and he did it with great authority. So the Christian church as a whole takes a whole lot of its teaching authority from Jesus himself, obviously. But then the church has a long history too, over 2,000 years. And in the early church, of course, a lot of the teaching was done by the apostles and the first leaders of the church. And after, you know, quite a few centuries, eight, nine centuries, and during what is called the medieval church, none of the teaching responsibility went into monks and monasteries, and that's very, very important to see that development. As you go through your book, you may want to look at some of the things that I particularly highlighting tonight for you, because I'd be looking for, particularly if you're going to do a project, a basic understanding of these things. And right now what we're doing is the historical perspective of Christian education. Now, about over 500 years ago, we have what is called a Reformation. That's when we get most of the Protestant churches that we know today. Methodist, Presbyterian, all the other, churches that are not Roman Catholic. The Christian education took on different kind of a system that was traditionally done in the church for over the centuries. No longer is it necessarily done by monks and brothers and sisters and so forth. Now you actually have schools almost like public schools, but they're Christian schools over the centuries that were started. Now, but then there's Reformation of the Catholic Church itself, sometimes called a Counter-Reformation, and indeed became a very, very, very powerful vehicle for Christian education. The Jesuit Society of Jesus, which many of you are probably familiar with, have a long, long history of Christian education, teaching from primary school to universities. So many of the great universities that we have today are still Jesuit schools. And so the Christian education became more than just teaching religious subjects, and branch off to the fact that in order to understand religious subjects better, one would need to know or be prepared in other subjects. And it makes sense, because for instance we're doing the historical perspective of Christian education, but it would be helpful if a person would have a knowledge of history. So if you have studied history, it would certainly give you a head start in understanding the historical perspective of Christian education. Now, it's all in the in your book, and you should find it exciting. Many of the things that are in that first chapter. Of course, part of the development of all of these things came what we know as the church school, Sunday school. And today, when we think about things like new members, classes, and other things of that nature, we definitely can understand how this came about as a natural growth of the long history of Christian education in the church. And chapter 2 deals with the philosophical foundation of Christian education. Many of the philosophers, even from the very early church, but somewhat involved in the teaching of religion. And as a matter of fact, sometimes the lines seem a little blur. But definitely methods of teaching, way of thinking about teaching Christianity have similarities and some roots and influences in philosophy. And when we think about the philosophical foundation of Christian education, you look on page 26, you see a definition of Christian education. And reading through this, you may get the impression, and it is correct, that it's been very hard to define Christianity in any one and rigid way. But when you think about the great strides that in the 1900s that secular education made, you can see parallels to great strides that Christian education made. So many educational thinkers, for instance, if you look at page 28, such as John Dewey, people seek to use his methodology, his way of thinking, his philosophical way of thinking, and apply that in Christian education. But there's some things that is worthwhile thinking about, and they're mentioned starting on page 29. The philosophical thinking of, for instance, metaphysics, that which goes beyond physics. Some might say, well, that's what we call spiritual. When we look at what philosophy, all the different aspects in which philosophy have argued and thought about this, we can see how some of this was applied in Christianity. Epistemology, the way of knowing things, was another philosophical way in which affected the way we think about Christianity. There are many others. I think what you may find most interesting is epistemology, metaphysics. I think on page 32, existentialism, and you really need to understand what the author here is saying, because sometimes that word is kind of bashed around and not properly understood. But some philosophers that you may want to have at least a cursory knowledge of, you may want to Google, is Descartes, and if you look at the top of page 32, Pascal, Kierkegaard, Nietzsche, Barth, the really theological writers, of course, starting with Barth and Bultmann, Tillich, Paul Tillich. You may want to, Google them and see how, philosophers like Descartes and Pascal and Nietzsche what you may find in relationship to theologians like Tillich and Barth and Bultmann. There's a course that we don't particularly teach. I've taught it to ministers for many, many years. It's a philosophical foundation of Christianity. And that kind of let the ministers get an understanding of how the relationship between theology and philosophy. Some may say, you know, accurately or not, some may just say, well, theology is a philosophy of God. Some people may not necessarily agree with that kind of assessment, but there's no question that understanding philosophy helps someone, helps us to understand theology better. So when we get to chapter 3, then we talk about the theological foundation of Christian education. So you start with getting some kind of basic understanding of the history of Christian education, starting with the Old Testament and the long history of the Old Testament to the New Testament, and after the New Testament, the church, the early church, the medieval church, church of the Middle Ages, what we call the Middle Ages, after the Reformation of the early 1500s, and down to what is called by some people today postmodern Christian education. So it's good to get some grasp of that, if you can. When we talk, for instance, when we talk about postmodern Christian education, look how easy it is today to just Google a lot of stuff, and it saves us time, and we can do fabulous research today just by Googling stuff. Now, we talk about the Old Testament time of the Christian education, really a function of the family, in many cases a function of the father, and they couldn't Google anything. And in fact, we see how for centuries during the Egyptian bondage of the people, that learning about God was actually almost totally lost. So we have this great blessing and privilege that we can not only go back and look at these things through Googling them, or we can reflect on them with a greater understanding, because so many things are at our fingertips. Now, in the Old Testament, not every family taught about God. So nothing's ever monolithic. Everybody's never doing everything that they should. So you need to kind of read up a little bit more if you want. If you want more information than what the book is giving you. How sometimes, in many instances, we talk about brothers teaching, monks teaching, but many times they were teaching other monks when it was done in monastery. It wasn't necessary for the public. Christian education did not really amount to anything near what we would what we experience it today until after the Reformation, after the early 1500s, because again, the interpretation of the Bible, the studying of biblical languages, that was really done by people who specialized in that in the church, and these wasn't even all the monks and all the priests. But the average person, Christian education would amount to mostly understanding the liturgy, what they were taught in the church about worship, not necessarily biblical interpretation, what we call today hermeneutics and things of that sort. That wasn't done. So you need to understand the development of this stuff. Also, you know, when we talk about the Bible being translated into many different languages, it part of what facilitated that was the printing press. Once printing became something that was a reality, that what was being published at first, you know, was the Bible. And people learn eventually how to listen, and later on, some learn how to read the Bible in their own language. Now, Christian education has always had its challenges. If you go back to the Old Testament, you see that not all rabbis agree with interpretation. We can see from the five first books of the Bible that the priests had their ways of interpreting scriptures. People who saw God more as a loving, kind God, Yahweh, you know, their way of understanding God was a little bit different, more from the Hellenists, those who saw God as more of a stern God. So you had these different codes, we call them, and you can see how interpretation varies. Even to this day, we see that in the first five books of the Bible. And then as it went along, you can see that, you know, one of the issues that came up after the Reformation, and the Bible is now being translated into other languages, and translating one language to another language is never a perfect thing. So different interpretation came out of it. And of course, from that, different denominations came out of it. People understood things differently. And so more and more denominations keep coming up. So that has been the challenges as we go along. So even the postmodern period, or in the present day period, and contemporary period, we have various challenges. But the proliferation of biblical translation, it's so much easier to translate now, so much tools that scholars have at their command, but that it doesn't necessarily make us necessarily agree on what it is we're reading and what it is we're teaching. So sometimes our teaching comes out much different from others, and others, you know, understanding and teach somewhat different from us. But always, before we get into theology, the foundation of Christian education, theological foundation of Christian education, always God has his purpose. God eventually triumph in all of this. And the important thing is that the Word of God is being taught. Whether with total agreement or not, the Word of God is being taught. So without Christian education, there'll be no teaching of the Word, in the sense of people knowing that there is a God and what God is telling us through His Word. Okay, everybody's all right. If you have any questions, you may want to type them in now. In fact, I'm going to take a minute before we go to the theological foundation of Christian education to make sure that everybody is, you know, feel comfortable. I'm going to just take a moment, see if anybody has anything to share. Amen. See if anybody has anything to share. Now you must sign in. You can sign in either by typing in your name, typing in your initials, or emailing me. I know who's on the telephone. That's fine. But I would need to know those who are on the internet, and those on Roku needs to sign in by emailing me. Amen. So again, any questions or anything to share? Now, if you sign in through Facebook, I will know who you are. If you're using your own name on the web page, I know who you are. If not, you have to either put your initials down in the box or drop me a note, email, or message me, send me a message, a text message, or whatever, so I would know that you were present in the class. And that's only if you are doing this for credits. If you're doing this for credit for 2-year certificate, if you're doing this for for enjoyment, if you're doing this for enrichment, you don't have to let me know that you're here. And and fine. And if you just want to listen in, you can too. And just tell your friends. The theological foundations of Christian education. Theology is simply, I guess, the simplest way we could put it. It's not simplistic, but the simplest way we could put it is the study of God. So, in a sense, Christian education is the vehicle that let us do a kind of theology whereby we learn and we teach about God. Now, we may do this in various ways. And as you know, in the instruction portion that we did last week, we talked about seminars, workshop, you know, and various type of things, vacation Bible school, whatever, but the purpose is to learn about God. Now, the foundation, therefore, one of the basic things about theology in terms of Christian education would be, of course, the Bible. And for many people, that is the basic thing, that's where everything falls on that. But then there's pedagogy and other things. How do we teach? What are the methods of teaching? How do we teach those who are a challenge in their learning abilities, or do we teach toddlers and youngsters or elderly people? How do we teach people coming from a different faith, a different religious understanding? How do we teach, people whose culture is entirely different from ours? So it's not, these are the various aspects that goes into Christian education. If you look at page 37, you see some important, I'm highlighting for you some things that you should pay attention to. One, of course, is that many people are Trinitarians. Not everybody is who are Christians, but as Trinitarians, of course, you would need to understand about the Trinity. But apart from that, there is a study called Christology, and that is the person studying about the person and the work of Jesus. There's pneumatology, which is the study of the person and work of the Holy Spirit. And since theology is the study of God, and Christology and pneumatology becomes important, they become important facets of theology. Many others, of course. Now, a few other things that you may want to pay attention to is the basic tenets of Christianity. And if you look at 39, it explains, for instance, justification and sanctification. And you can look up more of these things, holiness, regenerations, and things of that sort. For all Christians, somehow or other, we cannot escape eschatology. And if you look on page 40, eschatology is the study of the end times, our hope and our eventual going to heaven and meeting up with Jesus. And so that become an important part of our Christian education in terms of theology. I'd like to turn to page 43 and look at the conclusion. It's helpful to get an understanding of introduction, and then it's also important to get an understanding of conclusion or summarizing. So on the bottom of page 43, to maintain evangelical distinctives in formulating both theory and practice in Christian education, we must become more aware of how our presuppositions and approaches influence development of curriculum, instructional design, pragmatic development, and so forth. First thing I'd like to say about that is that, again, just like just any other discipline, we need to understand the theory, the technique, the methodology. How do we do what we do? How do we reflect on what we do, and then the practical part of it, how do we actually do it? In terms of Christianity, how do we actually live it? So one thing would be knowing how about all the methodologies, but how do we actually put it into practice? As Christian educators, we can help our people enter into Christ-like living and deeper relationship. And evangelicals and others would definitely put great emphasis on Christian education to the ultimate aim of saving souls. So that people may have a deeper relationship with God, and we ourselves do as Christian educators, by letting sound theology have its proper role in Christian education theory and practice. So we may study philosophy, not because we want to become philosophers, but to see how we can use those vehicles to get a better understanding of theology so that we can apply it to people's lives, so that in the end it might save souls. So one's theology, our theology, must be predicated upon a solid conviction that God's word is trustworthy. That's another way of saying you have to believe in what we're studying and what we're teaching. That should be a given. Many evangelicals hold to the inherent view of Scripture. This is the belief that the Bible alone is authoritative and speaks for God. Without such a view, one's theological moorings are as firm as the latest fashion trend. So the book is going to emphasize us believing in God, believing in the Word of God, so that when we teach it with conviction. When we practice it with sincerity. And when we apply with all faith in God. Again, I'll take a minute to see if there are questions or anything to share. And if you haven't gotten your book yet, you'll have some catching up to do. I gave you last week all the dates of the classes. If you're joining us tonight, you can go and look at the recorded tape from last week, and it will give you all the dates that we're meeting. Every time we meet, we're going to cover at least 3 chapters. So the next 3 chapters that we are sharing would be 4, 5, and 6. And so the class does call for a certain amount of reading. It's not a very big book, but there's a lot there that you need to read and get a good understanding of. So again, any questions or anything to share? So let me take a minute and give you a moment to see if you have any questions. Now, we think about Christian education from a historical perspective, because it's been going on for thousands of years. Now, when we say Christian education in the Old Testament, of course it wasn't called Christian education then, but what we know and what we call Christian education at its roots in the Old Testament, in the study of Torah, first five books of the Bible, in the study of Tanakh, that is the Old Testament, basically, as we know it. Because Christianity has its roots in Judaism, then Christian education roots was formative or started in the Old Testament. And so that's why it's important to understand where it all started. So, again, questions or anything to share? The early church fathers, as they were called, after the apostles and the first disciples had passed away, as the church grew and built, found ways of teaching people about Jesus, about God. At first it was done mainly in the homes of people. And so when we think about the historical perspective of Christian education, the teaching was, for the most part, for the first few centuries, also done in a family setting. But not just an immediate family like the Old Testament, but as small groups in houses. But those groups could probably involve lots of people too. There is a passage in the Acts of the Apostles and Paul teaching, and it seems like the place that they were in was extremely crowded, so much so that someone passed out and fell out of what seemed like a window. So, again, when we look at the historical development of Christian education, and I'm kind of summarizing this for the third time, the next big significant change probably came about when the monks and other people who were very pious, very religious, wanted to learn more and studied together and so forth. But a lot of that was done in monasteries and other settings that did not include the population at large. But when Martin Luther broke away from the Catholic Church, and we had what was called a Reformation, and eventually what the Reformation did was to have various churches keep branching out from each other, the Lutherans, the Anglicans, eventually Episcopalians, and eventually goes down and go on and go on, Pentecostal and so forth. Then the regular folks like us got more and more involved in learning about God's Word, and teaching God's word, and it became more of a church-wide and a denominational-wide and a Christian-wide endeavor. And then the Catholic Church, from which the people of the Reformation broke off, they themselves became great teachers of Christian education through groups like orders like the Jesuit. They may not have taught it in the way Protestant did in terms of, you know, all kind of Bible classes, but certainly there was great religious instruction that was going on. And part of Christian education is religious instruction. How do we worship? Why do we get baptized or christened? What are the meaning of these things? All these things are Christian education. Catechism, you know, eventually became known as, those are part of Christian education. And then it brings us to today. And here we are, streaming live. That is a vehicle and means of Christian education. TV and radio. And Christian education, like I told you what happened with the translation of the Bible into various languages, came about because of printing. Once printing became a way of people printing so that people could learn to read and read, what they were mainly reading in the very beginning was the Bible. The same things, therefore, many centuries later on, you have radio. So you have radio. Radio was news and eventually sports and so forth. And then Christian education got involved, from church services to Bible classes. Then there was television, the same thing happened. The computer is invented. Now you have the computer doing the same things. Now one can see the hand of God in all of this. So every time we have new development, new technology, whatever, God through His wisdom, using human beings, is able to spread the word of God. So, when you think about all of that, and then next time we meet, as I said, you can go to the first class that we have and get all the instructions, and find out the name of the book if you don't have the book, and also get an understanding that every class we're going to go over at least 3 chapters. So next time we meet will be part 4, organization, administration, and leadership.
We stop at the theological foundation of Christian education. So the next time we meet, we'll do chapter 4, 5, and 6. So chapter 4 is the cross-cultural perspectives on Christian education. Chapter 5 is evangelism and discipleship. And chapter 6 will be lifespan development. And that comes under part 2, developmental perspectives on Christian education. If you have questions, you can type them in. You can message me or text me, whatever. I'd be happy to answer you. And right now I'm going to stay live for a few minutes and give you a chance to think about what you may want to ask. And I would encourage you to ask questions. And I'm even going to remain live for a few minutes before we cut off. But even after we cut off, you can always still contact me, and I'd be happy to answer you right here, right now, if I'm able to. Now, if you don't want to use your name, you can just ask your question anonymously, and I'd be more than happy to answer your question. So, go ahead. If you have questions, let me know. If you have a question about anything, even something other than tonight's class, anything, I mean, in terms of the course itself, please let me know. Amen. Amen. So, those of you on the telephone, everybody's okay? Okay. So, God bless you. If you don't have anything to ask, then I'll be seeing you or hearing from you from the next class. Okay? God bless you. Good night. Okay, if there's nothing, somebody's trying to reach me, but it's not coming through, so you may want to email me or send me a private message on Facebook, because for some reason I'm not able to respond, so I see that someone is trying to reach me, and it's not coming through. Amen. So just I know who you are, and you can either send me an email or a text message or a message on Facebook. Amen. But God bless you. We're going to close out for tonight, and again, you can still send your messages in, and I'd be happy to answer them.